Hi everyone, welcome to the next in our series of St Luke's and St Paul's Church at Home videos. I hope you're all keeping well and safe at home at the moment. For you who don't know me, my name is Reverend Matt Malins. I'm the vicar of St Luke's and St Paul's, and it's great for you to join us. Now, as usual, we're going to start our service this morning by celebrating birthdays, and we've got two to celebrate today. First of all, Maddie. Maddie, here's a birthday biscuit coming your way. Catch. Second is Chris Goodwin. Chris, this one's coming your way as well. Catch.
Thanks, Matt.
Awesome. Now, I know a lot of you have been watching the news recently, and a question probably first and foremost in your minds is the news about churches possibly reopening for services. And I wish I could sit here and tell you that we're going to be opening our churches to services straight away, but the answer is I don't know if we can. The reason being that we are still waiting for the government to actually publish their proper complete guidelines at the moment, and we don't know what will or won't be allowed. So on the 4th of July, or even the 5th, when it's a Sunday, I'm afraid we probably cannot open our buildings to services. As soon as I do know what's going on and what is and isn't allowed, then I will let you know. But until then, I'm afraid it's just status quo. We're going to carry on as we are, worshipping together at home in our pyjamas. So let's start with a prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love and your presence among us. And Lord, I pray that you bless us today. Bless us as we worship you and as we love you. And Lord, we ask that you continue to minister to all of us in our own homes. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, over to our worship team.
Hi everyone. A song for everybody. Some actions too, perhaps.
going to read from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. Jesus appears to the disciples while fishing. Afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "Yeah, we'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not recognise that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you caught any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat. You'll find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple, whom Jesus loved, said to Peter, "It is the Lord." And as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. And when they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there, with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've just caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared to ask, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. They just knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks for that reading. So let's look in a bit more detail at this story of amazing catch of fish. My experience as a fisherman is terrible, if I'm honest. The one and only time I did go out on a boat to try and catch some fish, I was horribly seasick and I caught nothing. And the only time I ever did catch a fish, I was not trying to catch fish, I was trying to catch crabs on the seawall. And I caught a fish by accident. My crab line started zipping all over the place. I didn't know what was going on. And a local fisherman came and helped me, which was even more comedic because he actually had just come in his boat with a whole bunch of people who'd hired that boat with him to go and catch fish out at sea, and they'd failed. They caught nothing, and so much to their annoyance, they pulled out my crab line, and there on the end of it was a rather sizable sea bass. So there you go. But that's the situation our disciples were in. They were failing to fish, failing to catch fish, and yet they pulled out this massive haul, 153 of them. They probably counted them because that's how they divided them up. So it was recorded, 153 fish, far more than they ever expected. But this is a strange story because the first thing that makes me wonder about this story is, well, is it in the wrong place in John's Gospel? Because if you look at the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark and Luke, the story of the disciples catching fish is right at the beginning, it's part of their calling, especially in Luke 5, where he goes into a lot of detail about the story of them failing overnight and struggling. And then Jesus says, "Put your net over the other side." And what happens? An amazing catch. Is this the same story in the wrong place in John's Gospel? And I've been thinking about this a lot, and the conclusion I've come to is no, actually. I think this is repetition. I think, now I could be wrong, but I think this is the same event almost happening, but for a second time. For me, it's almost John trying to bookend the disciples' ministry or life with Christ. Because at the very beginning, what happens when he calls them? Miracle of catching fish. And possibly the last time they see him, a miracle of catching fish. John's putting a beginning and an end to their life together with him. But why? Well, when you read the next chunk of the chapter in chapter 21, it's all about the restoration of Peter, and I'm not really wanting to focus too much on that. But Peter says a crucial line when he first encounters Christ in Luke. He says, "Please leave me, Lord, because I'm a sinner." And actually, that's probably where Peter's feeling again in chapter 21 of John. He's denied him. He has walked away from him. He's probably feeling horrible inside. And as we read in the verses after our reading, Jesus puts his mind at rest and restores him in his relationship. But he's, in some way, he's preparing them for what's next. It's this beginning and end is Jesus saying, "I'm leaving you now, but I'm preparing you for what is to come. Preparing for you for your next stage in ministry." Because, and it's no irony, I'm in the shed here. Actually, what had they done after he'd died and come back? They'd gone back to their first career. They were fishing again. And Jesus is saying, no, don't go back to what you know. Go get ready for what's next. Get ready for the next phase of ministry. As he's called them the first time to follow him, he's calling them a second time to go beyond that for what's to come in Acts. But I think what's really struck me about this miracle, and actually some of the others in that we've studied in John so far, is where does the miracle happen? And as I was thinking about this miracle, it struck me that Jesus is quite a distance away from the miracle. He's on the shore and he's actually lit a fire and he's preparing for when they come in. But he's not actually at the event of the miracle. The miracle happens in the boat, in the water. It happens in the disciples' hands. Now, there's no denying that Jesus is the source of this miracle and all of these miracles in John. Jesus is the one that makes it happen. But it's not actually always in Jesus' hands that the event occurs. If we look back at some of the miracles we've looked at in John's Gospel, this is actually quite a recurring theme. You go right the way back to the beginning when we had the miracle of the water into wine. Where did the miracle happen? It happened in the vats with the servants who were being told what to do. In chapter 4, the healing of the official son. Jesus was nowhere near the son who was healed. And yet, the miracle happened at a distance. At the pool of Siloam, I know Jesus was there right next to the guy, but he didn't touch him. The guy just got up and walked, did as Jesus said. And the one that really got me on this line of thinking, the feeding of the 5,000. Where did the miracle happen? Well, it wasn't Jesus handing out the bread and the fish. It was the disciples. They were the ones who were breaking up the bread and the fish, and yet there was more. Every time they gave some out, there was more. It was in their hands. And then finally, Lazarus' resurrection. Jesus wasn't in the tomb with him. He was at a distance, and he commanded, "Come out, Lazarus," and they rolled the stone away. Actually, Jesus' physical contact with these miracles most of the time wasn't there. In the other Gospels, we hear so much, don't we, about Jesus laying on hands, or that wonderful miracle of the woman just reaching out and touching the hem of his robes. But no, John's miracles seem to all happen at a distance. Why? Why is John focusing, possibly, on this? Well, to sort of summarise today's miracle and also possibly the whole series of miracles that we've had in this Gospel, I think you need to think about John's Gospel and what he's doing. For me, I think, and I accept, that John's Gospel was probably the last one to be written. And it was probably written late in John's life, when he was possibly one of the last few who were alive who saw Jesus in the flesh. I think one of John's real sort of focuses is writing and preparing and encouraging the next generation of believers who possibly hadn't met Jesus face to face. He was filling in gaps that weren't there in the other three Gospels, but also I think he's trying to encourage those who hadn't actually had the physical presence of Christ by their side to say, do you know what? You possibly don't need it. You don't need Christ right there, right in person, for the amazing to happen. Because the primary focus, if you look at the end of chapter 20, is John saying, he was the Messiah, here's your proof. There is no other way of accepting it. It is undeniable that he was the Messiah. He was God, he came from God, and he is our Saviour. But actually, I think John is also trying to say to this next generation, do you know what? You don't have to have Christ physically there to do the miracles. There is no denying that Christ is the source of the miraculous. It is Christ who ordained all these amazing things to happen. But a lot of the time, they happened in other people's hands. And that's so true for us now. Because miracles can happen in our hands too. We don't actually have to have physically God in the room with us for the miraculous to happen. But we need to learn from the example of the disciples and from those who were healed. We need to be obedient. So often Christ laid out specific instructions. Do this. And they followed. And it quite often didn't make sense. You look at the feeding of the 5,000 and the water into wine miracles. You can almost see or hear in the inner monologue of those who are taking part, well, I have no idea what's going on here. This does not make sense. But they were obedient. They listened and they obeyed and amazing miracles happened. And that for me is the challenge I think I'm going to take away from this whole series is, am I listening? Am I obedient to what Christ is saying, even when it doesn't make sense? And then are the miracles happening? If I want to see miracles in the church, if I want to see miracles in my family, miracles in the community around me, then I need to obey. I need to listen and follow, especially when it doesn't make sense. And you talk to people of faith, those who've known and witnessed miracles, do you know quite often the stories in some respect or some aspect include something that says, do you know what, it did not make sense to do this, but I did it because I felt that's what God was saying, and the miracle happens. That's our challenge, I believe, from this. As a church, we need to recognise who Christ is. Recognise he is the Messiah. Recognise he is the one that can do the miraculous. But then we need to be obedient. Whether that is casting our nets on the other side of the boat, even though we know from a whole night's worth of fishing, there's no fish out there. Whether that is to divide up what we have so little of already, to discover it just keeps going on and on and on. That's our challenge as a church. Be obedient, be faithful, and Christ will bless us in that. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this miracle. I thank you that you commissioned your disciples onto their next step. But Lord, help us to recognise your commissioning in us. Help us to see what the next step is for us as well, and to follow that. Help us to have faith in you. And Lord, we want to be obedient, so speak clearly to us, so we recognise your commands. And help us to step out in faith when it doesn't make sense, so we can see your amazing miracles in the world around us. I thank you, Lord, that you love us, and you bless us. And we offer all this to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Turned into one. open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no
Jesus' disciples experienced the abundance of his generosity that day. So many fish, so unexpected after such a fruitless night's work. And that abundance is available to us. He wants us to receive his gifts too. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for all the gifts you give in such abundance. Please guide our prayers as we pray for your world, your church, and your people who need to receive your gifts today. We pray for your world, damaged by injustice and greed. Please pour out your gifts of justice and care. Give us a new sense of responsibility for our environment and help us to repair the damage that we've caused. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church throughout the world. Please send your Holy Spirit to all who seek to minister to those in need. Please inspire us. Show us where our help is needed and what we can do. Give us the gift of generosity so that our work can be resourced, making a difference and revealing your kingdom to everyone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your people. We come with so many problems from so many different situations, and yet we all come with an inbuilt need of your love and your compassion. So we ask, Heavenly Father, that you will pour out these gifts so that we would all know how precious we are to you and how much you care. Please give your gifts of healing and comfort to all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. We bring those people to you now and ask you to bless them today. And we join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning.
Well, I do hope you've enjoyed today's video and it's been useful or a blessing to you. But let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your rich blessings that you pour out upon us. Lord, I ask that you keep us safe. Help us to flourish in these difficult times. And Lord, we look forward to the time when as a church we can come back together. Lord, let that be a joyous day and help us to do it safely and to be blessing to one another in that time. So Lord, we look forward to that and we praise you in the meantime. In Jesus' name, amen. So the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. And go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.